Hey, welcome. Today, we're diving into a real economic puzzle, one that seems to break one of the most basic rules we know about how markets work. Get ready, because what we're about to explore might just change how you think about the global economy.
You know, we're all taught that when demand for something shoots up, the price follows right behind it. But have you ever stopped to think about prices that just don't change? They seem to be completely set in stone no matter how much of a product people are trying to buy. So let's treat this like a puzzle we're going to solve together. Because once you see the answer, it reveals something really fundamental about power and scale in our modern world. Right, so normally it's pretty simple. If a whole lot of people suddenly want to buy coffee, the price of coffee is going to go up. That's usually how it works. But that's the rule. And today, we're here for the exception. Okay, so to really get our heads around this exception, we've got to look at the two polar opposites of supply. Think of them as the two absolute extremes of how things can be sold. So on one hand, you've got what's called perfectly inelastic supply. Think of a one-of-a-kind painting. There's only one, so its price is whatever people are willing to pay. But what we're focused on today is the other extreme, perfectly elastic supply. This is where the price is fixed. And trust me, this is where things get really cool. Now, this whole idea of a fixed price, in economics, it's shown as a perfectly horizontal supply curve. Yeah, it might just look like a flat line on the graph, but that line is the key to understanding a huge piece of international trade.
So what does this actually mean? Well, it basically means a seller is ready to sell you as much as you want, any amount at all, but always at the exact same price. They don't need to lower it to attract buyers, and they have no reason to raise it because they can literally meet any demand that comes their way.
And here's what that looks like. That price level on the side, it's just locked in. It doesn't move an inch, no matter how much the quantity, that's the number along the bottom, goes up. The price is constant, and that has some massive implications. Let's make this super clear. If something costs 10 bucks a piece, it costs 10 bucks. Doesn't matter if you buy 100 of them, 600, or even 1,000. The price per unit is locked. It simply does not budge. Okay, so this is the big question, right? It's all well and good to draw these lines on a chart, but where on earth does this actually happen? What kind of product or market actually operates with a totally fixed price like this?
And the best way to picture this is with a classic analogy: a small fish in a massive pond. No matter what that one little fish does, it's just not big enough to have any real effect on the pond itself.
And that brings us to the real world answer. This economic model, this horizontal supply curve, perfectly describes what happens when a small country tries to buy things from the huge global marketplace. Okay, let's walk through it. So picture this. You've got a giant manufacturer, maybe in China, pumping out millions and millions of TVs. Then you have a small country, say Israel, that wants to buy 100,000 of them. From that huge producer's perspective, an order of 100,000 TVs, that's barely a blip on the radar. It's a drop in the bucket, and it's certainly not big enough to make them change their prices. So for Israel, the price is fixed.
You know, there's a quote in our source material that just nails it. It says that for a global giant, the entire demand of a small country might as well be the demand of a single neighborhood. It just doesn't register enough to move the needle on the global price.
And all of this leads us to a really important idea in economics: the difference between being a price taker and a price maker. All right, so let's recap what we figured out here. This perfectly elastic supply, that horizontal line, is the perfect model for how small countries buy imports. In this giant global market, these countries become what we call price takers. They don't set the price, they have to accept the world price. And what this really shows us is the incredible economic power that comes with producing things on a massive, massive scale.
So here's the bottom line. It really all comes down to scale. When you are the small fish in the big pond, you don't get to make the waves. You just have to swim in them and take the price as it's given.
And that leaves us with one final, really interesting question to think about. If being a price taker is all about being small, what would it actually take for a country, or even a company, to grow big enough to become a price maker? But hey, that's a story for another time. Thanks so much for joining me on this one.